So before lunch, we saw some interesting talks on axioms and compilers and APLs and stuff like that. Let's get to the ground a bit and talk about some stuff on the JVM, seemingly much more boring platform, so to speak. Myself, Debasish Ghosh, I work for Lightbend. And I have been attending this conference, functional conf, almost every year, except 1 year, I guess. And I enjoy speaking here. So thanks for inviting me once again. The subject of my talk is managing effects in domain models. When we are building domain models, which are not that trivial, it's not only composition of some pure functions, right? There are other things to take care of. For example, I/O. We need to interact with the databases. We need to interact with the file system. We need to write to sockets and things like that. The question is, how do we take care of that in a purely functional world? We want to have all the goodness of functional programming as part of our model, and yet we need to address the effects, address the side effects that will come in our way while implementing the domain model. So this talk gives you a few options, discusses a few design paradigms on the JVM using a statically typed programming language. I will use Scala for this. Just a show of hands, how many of you were there in my earlier talk in the tutorial for the JVM, for Scala? Okay, quite a few. And some of the slides in this talk will be a repetition from the earlier one, but I will skip through them fast because they, first of all, they speak about basic things which have already been discussed many times in this conference so far, because I have quite a few slides to discuss and I will keep them for the last ones. So as I was talking, we all talk about the goodness of functional programming, programming with pure values, immutability, how functions are just like mathematics and things like that, equational reasoning. But how do we handle this stuff which are not so good, means which are not so pure, not so referentially transparent? For example, file I/O, database reads, and things like that. We call them side effects. How do we manage side effects so that they can be good inhabitants to the algebra of our domain model? How many of you were there in Tony's talk yesterday when he talked about parametricity? Quite a few, okay. So one of the central themes of purity in functional programming is this concept called referential transparency. I'll not go into the details of it, just to mention that an expression is said to be referentially transparent when you can replace the expression by its value within the program, and we don't have any other impact as part of the program. The program remains the same. So referential transparency is one of the values which will be core to the discussion today. And the basic idea is how to use side effects, how to transform side effects into values which are referentially transparent. This is a simple example of a referentially transparent expression. We have this val str. We create a tuple using str, and instead of str, we use its value, and the values remain the same. So it's a purely referentially transparent expression. Now, what about this? There's an iterator, right, which has a shared mutable state. And the moment we substitute a with the value, the call to the function, the values change, the results change. And that's because of the underlying shared mutable state which is there as part of the iterator. So this is an example of an expression which is not referentially transparent. So referential transparency enables local reasoning. What exactly do we mean by this? Because when we have multiple sub-expressions, and each individual expression, if it doesn't have any dependency on any external services or amongst each other, then we can reason about each of these expressions individually. So that's what we mean by local reasoning. So if each expression depends only upon the input and the output, without any interaction with the external world, in that case, we can reason about those expressions locally. So that's local reasoning. And if we have referentially transparent expression, then we have local reasoning. And local reasoning leads to function composition. We can compose functions when they are referentially transparent, because side effects don't compose. This takes us to this concept of side effects, which is something which breaks referential transparency. So an expression can either be referentially transparent or it's a side effect. There's no in between. Side effects do not compose, they are not modular. And here are some of the examples: shared mutable state, database rights, reading from standard input. These are all concepts you are familiar with. The problem is side effects are ubiquitous. Side effects you will encounter in almost all parts of the application. Unless it's a very trivial application, you can't avoid side effects. Now the question is, how do we deal with side effects in functional programming? They break modularity, right? Hence, we need to handle them somehow within the realms of our type system. We are using a statically typed language. We have the power of the type system. So we want to use the power of our type system so that we can still work with the pure values till the time we have to interact with the runtime system. So we have to handle side effects such that they remain pure values till the time we submit our program to the runtime system. FP is all about pure expressions. That's why functional programming is often called expression-oriented programming, as opposed to statements and actions in imperative programming, which tend to mutate things. So one way to handle actions and statements is to defer their execution. We need to be lazy. We will not execute the action at that point in time. What we'll do is we'll lift all actions into a container. You can think of it as a container sort of thing, where we prepare the recipe of how the execution will take place. Instead of executing the whole thing, we are still preparing a value, right? By accumulating stuff within a container, we are preparing the recipe of how to do the execution later in the stage of the program. So this is one option we can handle. So, and as long as we have an unevaluated action, it's still a value. So we are still in the land of referential transparency. And it is this value that we are calling an effect. Now, here's an example. We have a bunch of functions. All of these are pure. And we can compose them together to build a larger function as we can see here. We can compose these functions to build a larger abstraction. We could do this because these functions are referentially transparent and the types also align. We cannot compose just any two functions. The types have to align. The type algebras have to align. And here the types align. And because of that, we are able to compose the functions and build a larger function. The challenge is to do the same thing with the same semantics of algebraic compositionality in the presence of side effects. How far can we go? How far can we stretch this paradigm of compositionality in the presence of side effects? And one of the tools in our toolbox is the type system, the types. Now, as we saw earlier also, types are algebraic. And one of the things which we can do with anything algebraic is composition. So we can compose functions when the algebra of the types align. Now, here's an example of a function which is side effecty. It computes the salary of an employee for a specific month, and as part of it, it does a lookup from the database, it reads information related to employee, and then it computes the salary. So it's a side effective function. That's not what we want. We would rather have it this way. We divide the entire execution into two parts. Step one is building up of the recipe of how to execute. And step two is the actual execution. Step one is completely referentially transparent. Step one builds the steps, builds the recipe of how I should compute the salary, taking input from the database. And in step two, when I do an unsafe run sync, I actually submit it to the runtime system, and then the execution takes place. So till the time, we are at the end of step one, we are still in the land of values. We are referentially transparent. So we can compose this recipe with some other recipe. For example, say we have some other recipe for computing tax. We can compose these two recipes together to build a larger recipe, which we could not do if we had executed the function earlier and got the value of the salary. So this way, by doing it in two steps, by being lazy with the execution, what we are achieving is we are achieving compositionality. So this is the intuition. As part of the first step, we create a description of the computation. And in the next step, we submit it to the runtime for execution. Step one is referentially transparent, step two is not. So here, if you noticed, what we did is we put the recipe into a container-like thing called I/O. Think of it as a container. The container contains the recipe. And we call such structures I/O a type constructor, because it's a valid type. It's a concrete type when we supply an argument to the type. So abstract side effects into type constructors. That's what we were doing. And these type constructors are what we are calling the effects. We have a large number of effects. These are not all. These are some of them. I/O reads from the external sources. Either is the effect of disjunctionality. Option is the effect of partiality. We can have value or not have value. That we can abstract into the effect of partiality. For state management, we have the state thing. And if you look closely into each of them, they have a common shape. It's the FA, where A is the value. A is the answer that the effect computes. A is the value that we get ultimately. For example, there we had I/O salary. So salary is the thing which we ultimately get out of this. And F is the computation or the effect which helps us doing that. Yeah, the execution needs to be deferred. Till the time we need to compose. Till that time we need to compose values. Now the F, which you saw, F is an opaque type. We haven't yet associated any denotation to this effect, to this F type, which we will do later. In this talk, primarily I will focus on the I/O effect, which is related to interacting with external systems. And I/O is possibly one of the most common effects that we need to handle when we are implementing a domain model. So let's take a look at some code. This is an algebra of one of the artifacts of a domain model, an account repository. The purpose of this algebra is it gives you the contract to fetch stuff from the database or read and write, basically interact with the database. It gives you an abstraction. This repository term comes from domain-driven design concepts, and account repository is one of those repositories. Now, I have these methods called query and store. The return type is I/O. I/O option account, I/O account. So it's effectful, right? So these functions, we call them effectful. But effectful but monomorphic. Those of you who were with in Tony's talk yesterday must have seen this, that it violates parametricity. Whether to use I/O as the effect type or something else is a decision which the end user should take. And here we have taken the decision on behalf of the user. So So let's turn that into parametric type. We are now parameterizing the effect type as part of the contract of the algebra. So now account repository is parameterized on the effect type, which is a type constructor M, and now the functions return the effect type as M. We will see how this helps us. But before that, a few notes on parametricity. As we saw earlier, when we make an abstraction parametric, it's more generalized. So it's less constrained. So it has a lesser number of implementations. So it's easier to reason about. Lesser number of possible implementations because it's more generalized. If you have a contract with type M, you really don't know what M is. So you can't really write much as part of the implementation. Polymorphic, because we can vary M, we can choose various values of M. So it's parametric polymorphism. And theorems for free, as we saw earlier also in earlier talks, that if you make your contract parametric, you can deduce a number of theorems just by the look of the types which your functions take. This paper is a great read, Theorems for Free by Phil Wadler. Here's an example. Suppose you need to write a function which the purpose, the implementation of the function deals with folding some stuff. So a common usage which we tend to do is pass it as a list, pass the argument as a list. But if instead of list we pass a foldable makes lesser number of assumptions. Foldable is a much more generalized data structure than list. It has a much more generalized contract. So the number of possible implementations using a foldable will be much less than what you would have with list. So if the only stuff that you are doing is folding over a collection or folding some stuff, in that case it makes sense to pass foldable as the argument type rather than list. Okay, back to our account repository. Now, this is the contract for an implementation of that algebra. Note that this is also parametric on M. But here, what we have done is we are still generic on M, but I have constrained the genericity to include the restriction that M needs to have a monad. I would like to handle error through the class monad error, through the type monad error, which implies that M is a monad. This is from Katz library. So note that the implementation 2 does not depend on the specific type of M. Implementation is also generic. And the immediate benefit which we will have is we can now instantiate account repository using various types of effect types with IO or with monix eval task. So here we have this polymorphic effect of M. Since we didn't commit to an initial implementation, so because of that we can use various types of concrete effects in order to instantiate the various types of repository implementations. Any question till now? No, local reasoning is a general concept which can be applied at various levels. Suppose you have a complicated function and this function computes two different things by calling two different functions. So if these functions are referentially transparent, then it's easier to understand those functions by considering them, reasoning about them locally. You can just consider function one and you can analyze that. It doesn't depend on function two or it depends on any external sources. So since it's by referential transparency, we mean that it only takes some input and gives some output. It doesn't depend, the output only depends on the input which you give to the function. Local means the local scope of the function. Yeah, local scope of the function. Yes. Composability is possible, but polymorphism you lose. by making things parametric upfront, you are leaving some of the decisions to be made by the user, which actually should be made by the user. So here are some takeaways. We have a parametric and effectful algebra and an implementation. Parametric algebra with effectful functions. Referentially transparent implementation where effect is constrained to a monad. Can be used polymorphically with multiple specialization of the effect type, IO and task we saw. And these types of design tend to be modular. They can be tested in isolation because they are pure values, referentially transparent and things like that. And since it depends on some specific algebra, for example, the algebra of monad, the implementation depends on the algebra of monad. You can, during testing, you can pass on a very simple version of the monad to test. For example, in some cases, if your function takes a monad, you can pass the identity monad for testing. Whereas in production, it can be a different kind of a monad. So it's unit testable because it's modular. So we saw one artifact of our domain model, a repository. But usually artifacts do not stand in isolation. They have to be composed, right? They have to be, for example, repositories need to be passed on to the services, domain services. So now we will see how repositories can be passed on in an effectful way to a domain service so that the effect remains the same. The service will also be effectful, right? And the repository is also effectful. So in that case, we can pass the repository to a domain service using the same effect, and there also we will use the power of the type system. So this we call the composition of effects. We will compose the algebras of the repository and the domain service, and this composition will be through types. So the next step will be to design a domain service that composes with the account repository algebra, which means the same effect is propagated down from the repository to the service module. Just a refresher, this is how function composition works, F A to B, G B to C, and we can compose this to get A to C. And we have the identity functions, and now compare this with this diagram, which is basically the same, only thing is that the functions are effectful. So instead of A to B, we have A to FB and B to FC. And now we need one and then function. This is not plain composition. So plain function composition will not work here because we have the effect. And those pure functions, what they do is they take pure values and lift into the context of the effect. There's one class called Clisely. Clisely basically wraps a function application. It takes A to FB and gives us a wrapper. And Clisely actually implements an effectful and then, by which you can implement function composition over effectful functions. Now this implementation is not complete, but as you can see that here we have, let's try to guess the implementation. Here I have the run which takes an A and gives me an FB, and I need to implement and then, which takes a B to FC, and I have the run there. So what I can do, I can prepare a Clisely. My intention is to prepare A to FC, which is Clisely FAC. So I can prepare a Clisely which takes an A, and on that A I can invoke run. So that will give me an FB, right? So now I have an FB and an argument, and then has an argument B to FC. So now I have FB and B to FC, and I need to get FC. Any idea how I can get there? Any familiarity? Sorry? Flat map. We can constrain F to be a monad, and if we invoke flat map on that, it will give me the desired type algebra. So this is the simple implementation of effectful function composition in a statically typed setting, where just by aligning types and constraining some algebras to some specific effect types, here we have constrained F to the effect type of a monad, I can implement effectful composition, effectful function composition. Inverse. Yeah. Not only FB, I have A to FB, and also I have this B to FC. So if you look at the signature function signature of flat map, you will see that the types align beautifully to give you FC. Having an FB and an A to and a B to FC, I can reach FC. Kleisley also gives us a monad, so that Kleisley's you can compose using four comprehensions and monads. So now let's look at our domain service algebra. Domain service needs to have a repository, and so the algebra of the domain service states that it takes a bunch of arguments, it takes an account repository and gives us an effectful account, right? The first thing to note is that we have the same effect types, and since we specified M in both the places, this means the type system will enforce me to pass the same effect type when I'm instantiating the account service and when I'm instantiating the account repository. So this is ensured by the type system. And the return type is nothing but a Kleisley. Now the good part is, even with the implementation of a service, I have not yet committed to any specific effect type. It's still M. It's still parameterized on M with the additional constraint that M needs to be a monad. And because M is a monad, I have monad error. I want to do error handling using monad error, which makes me think of M as a monad. I can use flat map, which again comes from the monad. And I can use raise error, which again comes from monad error. So besides the constraint that I have imposed on the effect type, I am not using any other concrete information regarding the type of the effect because I don't have any. So this entire thing is from Katz effect IO. Katz effect. So is this part clear, that the implementation is also parametric in the effect type, and we have not yet committed to any implementation? And most important of all, we are still in the value land. All these APIs, all these methods return Kleisley, which is a value, because we haven't yet executed anything. So what our model achieves, it's a parametric and effectful algebra of the service that composes with the effect of the repository. An implementation that uses the constraints of the algebra of the effect type, and it's still independent of any concrete effect type, as I was telling you. Monadic with Kleisley arrows for effectful function composition. We used Kleisley for composition, and service methods composed through flat map because Kleisley gives us a monad. So it's not related to any concrete type. It's not, so once again, a repetition of what I told earlier. And Kleisley lifts your computation into an effect. So this is an example of a sample program that uses the account service. Now there are several things to note here. This is the final program which we have written. So here we need to give a concrete instance of the effect. I am using Katz effect IO here. Now using this for comprehension, this looks like an imperative program, right? Do this, first open, credit, debit, in sequence, right? It looks like an imperative program. But in reality, it's imperative only to the extent that it creates the recipe. When you run this for comprehension, it will not execute anything. It still is creating the recipe. And any guess what the type of res will be? Kleisley. And Kleisley takes a repository, right? In our case, Kleisley takes an account repository, and the moment we supply that repository, Kleisli gives me back. Remember Kleisli FAC, A to FC, so A was repository. When I substituted A with account repository, I get back FC, and F in my case is IO. So the result of this will be an IO, which is still a value, by the way. We haven't yet executed the program. So we have written the entire program, we have instantiated everything, and still we are getting a value which is referentially transparent. Now this single step, unsafe run sync, this is the side effective part, but this is when we submit the program to the runtime system. Till that time I have the value, and in fact when I have this IO, I can compose it with other IO as well by getting some larger values. I may want to compose this IO, this account IO, with some other component which aligns with the type algebra to gives me a more meaningful abstraction, more bigger abstraction, larger abstraction. So what does this computation look like? So IO as an abstraction, it has not yet been realized. It's still a value and hence referentially transparent, as I was telling. And this is a very important paradigm of design which I try to follow. It separates the execution of the computation from the specification. This is not true for future, Scala future. Future is eager by default. But this laziness of evaluation is what gives us the power of composition. So if there is one thing you would like to take away from this talk, it's this. Separation of the two concerns. Separation of the execution from the recipe. IO is a monad and hence it allows composition through flat map. Now IO lets you do some other things also. IO lets you defer the choice of execution strategy. Once you have instantiated your IO, now typically how we want to run the program, whether we want to run it parallelly or sequentially, concurrently, we tend to take this decision upfront. But with IO, we have not yet committed to any specific runtime strategy, execution strategy. That you can do. You can either run it using unsafe run sync, in which case it will run the encapsulated effect as a sequential impure side effect, or you can choose to run it asynchronously. And this decision you are taking at this point in time, when you have built the complete abstraction, you have, so the abstraction is also independent of the strategy of execution. You can do unsafe run async, or even you can compile it to a future, Scala future. So effects are algebraic, IO is algebraic, IO has an algebra, modules compose when algebras compose. So here we have composed the two modules, the repository and the services. We have composed the two and come up with a larger abstraction. How am I doing with the time? How much? 11 minutes. Okay. Thank you. So effectful designs are referentially transparent till you submit to the runtime system. Okay, I need to go a bit fast. Acha, but domain services are not alone, right? We can have multiple domain services which may need to be composed together. So we have seen account service, but in reality, we can have some other service which does reporting service, and your final program may need to use both these services, right? So in that case, if you adhere to the algebra of the effect which we stated earlier, in that case you can actually mix all the services, you can compose all the services. Here balance by account, this function comes from the second service. So all of them, since all of them honor the compositionality of a monad, in that case, we can mix and match all of them and we can design a larger service, a larger program to execute. And once again, another side effect of this polymorphism thing is that this entire program is written using cat's effect IO. If I want to switch to Monix eval task, I just need to change IO to task. The entire program remains same. So what we have done so far is, we have defined the algebra with parametric effect type. We have implemented with constraints of effect type being monadic or applicative. It could be applicative also. We can compose with other algebras so long as they honor the type constraints, the type algebras, and do the specialization as late in life cycle as possible. Now, the next few slides will talk about slightly advanced stuff. This was the signature of our account service open method, right? We returned a Kleisli. M was our effect type. But it may so happen that in place of M, you can have a much complicated effect type, which is a stack of monad transformers, a monad transformer stack, because the effect types, all of the effect types may not be same, in that, in which case you may need to build a monad transformer stack. Now, monad transformers are not performant on the JVM. They do lots of heap allocations, because of which performance can degrade. There's this excellent blog post by John DeGoss, where he explains the various issues with transformer stacks, deeply nested transformer stacks. The question is, can we do better? The answer is yes, type classes. Instead of using the monad transformer stack, for each of the monad, if we can have a type class, then instead of using the stack, we can use the smaller grained type classes and have the same kind of effect without getting into that big stack. So there's a library, monad transformer library, which it's there in CATS, it's there in Scala Z also. So this library gives us these type classes. So we can use these type classes instead of using monad transformer stacks, and we can supply hand-rolled instances of the type classes. So this will have a remarkable effect on the response. There will not be as many heap allocations as with the transformer stacks. And using MTL is one of the recommended ways to develop such applications on the JVM these days. There will be some changes in the code. For example, applicative ask. Applicative ask is the type class corresponding to the reader monad or the Kleisli. So here we have gotten rid of the Kleisli thing. We are using a specialized type class, application ask, applicative ask. And using the ask method of applicative task, applicative ask, we can query for the repo, the account repository. This is a simplified version of applicative ask. It gives you this ask method. And if you look at these two algebras, you should see a similarity. The effect type is parameterized in both the cases. In this case, in account service, it's M. And in applicative ask, it's F. So the effect type is parameterized for the user to instantiate. So this type of design we call the tagless final. There are lots of papers on tagless final approach and how it leads to better composition of algebras. So you can take a look at those. But tagless final and MTL, these two are the potent combinations for developing effect-based generic applications, at least in Scala, on the JVM. So any question till now? I'm almost done. 5 minutes. So here are the final takeaways. Parametricity is a virtue. Try to use it as much as you can. Type constructors for modeling effects. Compose with values. Once again, I reiterate, separation between the specification of an abstraction, which is pure, and the execution by the runtime system. And use these above to wear the domain artifacts. The algebras need to align and so on. thread effects through domain behaviors using the selected denotation. Here the example was using monads. You can use some other as well. Avoid monad transformers if you are on the JVM. Use type classes for smaller grained effects. Roll out hand-rolled instances of type classes. It may seem daunting, but once you are into it, you will see that it's not at all difficult. Those type classes like applicative ask are really simple to instantiate. So provide your hand-rolled instances of those type classes so that the JVM doesn't have to do much to fetch the proper instance. No, it's not monad transformer. It's just the instantiation of the type class, the instance of type class for your specific data type. For example, in our case, we are injecting the repository, right? So applicative ask, we need to implement an instance of applicative ask for account repository. Yeah, it's actually 5-6 lines of code. It's not much. And in case you are interested, in this repo, I have a complete working implementation of this same example using all the options which we discussed. Monomorphic IO, MTL, and tagless final. So all of these implementations are there, so you can take a look at it. It's actually running code. Actually, the main confusion with MTL is the name. Monad transformer, the name, it's part of the name, but it doesn't have any transformer. Yeah, the name is possibly because of some historical reasons. Yes. Stacking all of them together leads to lots of heap allocations and things like that. So you can get rid of that using MTL. And last of all, be lawful. If you were in George Wilson's talk yesterday, then he discussed about the laws. So for all of these type classes which you write your own laws. So in that case, and verify those laws as well. And I would like to end with this quotation from Rob Norris. In one of the conferences, he mentioned this. Effects and side effects are not the same thing. Effects are good. Side effects are bugs. That's a very strong statement. Their lexical similarity is really unfortunate because people often conflate the two ideas. And in fact, Rob Norris has a couple of videos on YouTube on effectful design. So watch them. They are always recommended. And in case you are interested more in this on this subject, I have written a book which came out a couple of years back. So this also discusses some of these things. Yes, I'm done. Indian edition, I don't think so. I'm not sure. Yeah, I don't think it's available.
Support for a lot of functional constructs.
If the language supports functions as first class artifacts, first class citizens, then you can go to a lot of extent implementing these things. And but I prefer always typed language. So unless it's strongly typed, I'm not very sure.
Much flexibility that language provides for manipulating types in addition to
functions. It has a decent type system, in that case I think it's flexible enough. And at least two of the languages, Scala and Haskell, I have implemented similar stuff in both of them, so both of them are good.
So you talked about separating the recipe from the cooking, where you extract the recipe in
value
into a value. So now when you get to testing the recipe, I mean, here's where I've had a difficulty with intuition, because I have a recipe in memory, but I can't run assert statements to see if the recipe is correct. I have to actually run it through a monad to kind of see if the recipe is working correctly.
Actually that's what I was trying to say, that if you have the recipe, since it's a value, you can always test it in isolation. For example, you have a monad. Replace it with ID, identity monad.
Right. But what I meant was, unlike the typical checks with value, and here when I say value, I mean simple types like ints and strings. I can just run assert statements. But one of the difficulty that comes up here is you can no longer just do assert equality checks. You actually have to run it through a...
Yeah, you can do asserts, but you need to replace those effects, replace those effect types by simpler ones.
Simpler ones.
Thank you. I think we've run out of time, so.
Okay, so I'll be around. So in case you have any further questions, I'll always be.